Good morning. Let's all stand. We'll pray and we'll get started. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity that you have given us to gather together and to worship you corporately. Lord, we just pray that you dwell among us this morning and let us feel your presence, Lord. We just thank you again in Jesus' name. You're looking to live a perfect life, came to be, living a word of light, came to die, so we be reconciled, came to Yeah. Standing next to me was another in the war, holding back the sea. Should I ever need remind, set me free. There's a cross that bears the burden, where another died for me was another in the fire. Just goes to show that we are human.
It's been too many weeks, sorry.
So this is to remind you that your church family will be praying for you this school year and making sure that we remember you and all of the challenges sometimes that comes with school, as well as the teachers and administration and all that are gathering back from the summer vacation. So for our prayer this morning, I actually would like all of you to participate, and you are going to put your hands out like you're kind of anoint. I don't know if I use that word, but more of a bless and pray for Austin as he gets ready for the school year. So if you'll join me as we pray, you can stand or sit or however I do. Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, we pray for Austin as well as all of the students and teachers and administration and staff who are gathering together to start a new season, a new year. With excitement and joy, but we also know there's anxiety, there's fear, there's worry, and we ask that you strengthen them and guide them, especially Austin this morning, to remember your love and this here family in all of the moments when things seem challenging and painful, and also in moments of great joy, that you are with them and that your wisdom and guidance will be there. Amen. You also just want to wish you a well and good school year, and to remember that we are here, all of us are praying for you. That led us look up our announcements this morning, as well as joys and concerns, and I'll start with some of the announcements here. With the start of the school season, we also will begin and resume the choirs, both the chancel and the handbell choir. We'll resume this week for chancel choir, and handbell choir will resume next Wednesday. Also, there's still registration is still open for any Muscatine youth children's and Little's Angel choirs. So if you know of any children that would like to join that, or go ahead and contact Dan, or there's also print sign-up registration forms down by the front door. Next Sunday is our Chalk the Walk Sunday with First Presbyterian Church and Zion Lutheran Church. So anytime that you come that morning for whatever service you're here for, before you leave, there'll be chalk out in the main entryway, and go ahead and grab a few pieces of chalk, and the idea is to just chalk up our entire sidewalk around the church with positive messages or images that encourage people as they walk by. And then you're all invited over to First Presbyterian Church at noon that day, in their parking lot they'll be having hot dogs and kind of a potluck lunch. Do let them know so they can plan ahead for numbers if you are going to join them for that. Also, in the announcements, starting September 10th, I will be offering a 7-week membership course. It is open to anyone who wants to be a member, or if you just want to be reminded about what it is to be a United Methodist, or to learn because you don't know what that means, or the history behind it, anyone is invited to the course. Please let me know. It's Tuesday nights from 6 to 7:30 starting September 10th. And I need you to let me know because there are books that I'd like to have ready for that as well. And then next Sunday as well, following in the evening, is Fireside Fellowship Feast at 5:30 p.m. at Brad and Nancy Wall's house. You're welcome to come and bring a dish to share. There'll be a hot dog roast. And a great time for all at 5:30 that evening to fellowship and food. With that, are there any other announcements? Yes. Yes, I want to hear the news. Okay. Smiling, so that must be good news.
MRI. Friday, driving to Iowa City, along the river, in the distance, I see this chunk of concrete in the water against the bank. In the distance, as we get closer, we drive by, and the water just happened to hit the back of it. And I said to myself, are you telling me with our faith we can make concrete float? It looked like it was floating on the way to our MRI. Yes, that's called faith. Faith can make concrete float. I get there. MRI. In and out. Same question as always, which is, do we all remember? Doctor, happy or super happy? Super, super happy. Yes.
Amen.
Amen. Gloria a Dios. Go to the next doctor. In and out.
Prepare to receive and hear the word of the Lord. We are in the book of Nehemiah. This week we're in chapter 9, a continuation from last week where the wall has been rebuilt And they heard the word of the Lord read and wept with joy because they had all gathered from the further ends back home. So we begin here in chapter 9 after this has taken place. So hear these words. On the 24th day of this month, the people of Israel were assembled. They fasted, wore funeral clothing, and had dirt on their heads. After the Israelites separated themselves from all the foreigners, they stood to confess their sins and the terrible behavior of their ancestors. They stood in their place and read the instruction scroll from the Lord their God for a quarter of the day. For another quarter of the day, they confessed and worshiped the Lord their God. But our ancestors acted arrogantly. They were stubborn, they wouldn't obey your commandments, they refused to obey, and they didn't remember the wonders that you had accomplished in their midst. They acted arrogantly and decided to return to their slavery in Egypt. But you are a God ready to forgive, merciful and compassionate, very patient and truly faithful. You didn't forsake them. Even when they had cast an image of a calf for themselves, saying, "This is your God who brought you up out of Egypt," and holding you in great contempt, you, in your great mercy, didn't abandon them in the wilderness. The column of cloud continued to guide them on their journey during the day, and the column of lightning lit their path during the night. You gave your good spirit to teach them. You didn't withhold your manna from them, and you gave them water for their thirst. You kept them alive for 40 years. They lacked nothing in the wilderness. Their clothes didn't wear out, and their feet didn't swell. But they were disobedient. They rebelled against you and turned their back on your instruction. They killed your prophets who had warned them so that they might return to you. They held you in great contempt. Therefore, you handed them over to the power of their enemies, who made them suffer. But when they cried out to you in their suffering, you heard them from heaven, because you are merciful. You gave them saviors who saved them from the power of their enemies. But after they had rest from this, they again started doing evil against you. So you gave them over to the power of their enemies, who ruled over them. Yet, when they turned and cried to you, you heard from heaven and rescued them many times because of your great mercy. You also warned them to return to your instruction, but they acted arrogantly and didn't obey your commands. They sinned against your judgments, even though life comes by keeping them. They turned a stubborn shoulder, became headstrong, and wouldn't obey. You were patient with them for many years and warned them by your spirit through the prophets, but they wouldn't listen. So you handed them over to the neighboring peoples. In your great mercy, however, you didn't make an end of them, neither did you forsake them, because you are a merciful and compassionate God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. God, we thank you for your holy and wonderful word. May it breathe life into us. May it guide us to be ever more closer to you, Lord. May it convict us to turn back to you. And may the words that I speak this morning be your words for your people. Amen. Recently, last night, I realized I have a little bit of competitiveness in me. We were just finishing up dinner, and we had pizza for dinner. And Patrick remembered that I had purchased a bag of lettuce in the fridge. So he was going to make himself a bowl and asked me if I wanted any. And I thought about it, and to be honest, I don't really like salad, but I couldn't let him look good for eating a salad, and I not eat a salad. So of course I said yes, and I forced the salad down, which I do every time I eat salad because I don't really like it. But it was this competitiveness, you can't be healthy and I not be healthy, so I have to eat this salad too. And I tell this story because it did remind me so much of what it means to be the church and here in this passage. Not necessarily just the competitiveness, unless it's loving God so much more than the person next to you, so they love God. but more that this worship was an acknowledgement of growing in faith and love. That in fact, Patrick and I make each other better. If he's eating healthy and I'm competitive, then I'm going to eat healthy, which is good for both of us. That worship is meant to grow us, to make us more in love with God, and acknowledge God's love for us, that we grow and love other people more. And that's what happens here in Nehemiah chapter 9. As we continue in our sermon series, Revealing the Church, Nehemiah, last week we read chapter 8, and we read that they had finished building the wall. But Nehemiah going to Jerusalem was not just about the wall. Yes, it was a physical structure, a physical reminder that they were rebuilding the city, that they were able to gather there safely, but it wasn't about just the wall. Nehemiah's work was the work of the people, the work of God, that God had called them there to gather God's people back with Ezra as their priest and guide, that together they would be reconnected to their relationship with God, because the people had been scattered in exile. And here in chapter 9, it begins with an act of confession, and then what was read later on, starting later on in verses 21 towards the end, a lot of that was part of the story that they would have known, that we know in Exodus, where they leave Egypt from slavery, and they end up in the desert for 40 years. And so it is a retelling of that story, and how even in 40 years in the desert, God did not abandon God's people. When they turned away, when they did things like building a golden calf, even though they knew at that point they weren't supposed to build any idol or image of God, they did it anyways. God still forgave them and loved them. And then while they were in the desert for 40 years, God provided all that they needed. They always had food to eat. He provided manna in the desert. They had water when they were thirsty. Their shoes and clothes never wore out. Their feet never got tired. As it said here in Nehemiah, they continued because God was with them in the cloud during the day and with the lightning at night. So this worship that they have come to do, if you remember chapter 8, the words of God, these stories, were read. And reading and hearing these words, they had not heard for a long time, because they didn't have, like we do now, any access to a Bible or an app or things like that. The scrolls that the words would have been written on were very few and hard to find. In fact, Ezra probably and the priests are the ones that maybe had a copy of it. Maybe they had a copy of it. Most of the stories were told orally, passed down from generation to generation. But when they were scattered in exile, they lost connection of being able to go to a temple to hear the words read. They also were mixed in with the cultures of the places that they were at, so it had been a long time since they were gathered together and heard the word of the Lord, and heard the stories that they were told and remembered then, in that moment, from their ancestors, and their journey in the desert for 40 years. And then we're reminded by those same words how God was with them throughout, that God had never abandoned them. And they cried because it was so beautiful. And here in chapter 9 then, after they have cried in joy because they finally are together, they hear these beautiful words and remember these stories and how God has been with them, they then begin with confession. They mourn and they put sackcloths on and ashes on their head as a symbol of repentance and confession. And they begin to confess where they have gone wrong personally, but also they confess for their entire group, how even their ancestors, how they had gone astray and admitted that they were stiff-necked, and maybe we're still stiff-necked. In the translation I read this morning, it doesn't use that harsh of a term. It kind of makes it a little bit better that they disobeyed God, but in other translations, it's just straight out, they were stiff-necked. They would not follow God. They kept going their own way and were on the wrong path constantly of destruction, and God called them back and never left them. But God, in great mercy and love and forgiveness, was there continually guiding them and calling them to follow after God. Here in our scripture passage, and they have gathered in an act of worship. I remember at my last appointment, I started to begin putting in prayers of confession as part of the service. And usually I wasn't putting them in every week. They were usually in Communion Sunday. And one of the church members were very disgruntled. They were quite upset when they started seeing these prayers of confessions in there. And so I asked them about it. I was like, what's wrong with confessing? Where scripture tells us we are to confess. And they admitted that what had happened was a previous pastor a while back had put confessions in the service every single week, but they only put in the confession. They didn't put in what we call in theology world the assurance of pardon, which is after you confess, then you are assured that God is merciful and kind and gracious and loving and forgives you. So what in fact was happening is they were confessing and there was no response. So they were pouring out their hearts or reading group prayers of confession, and everybody was reading these words of how we have failed and turned away from God. And then they were leaving gloomy and upset because we're just bringing up all of our stuff and there's no resolution for it. There was no good news given to them after they had confessed. But really, when you confess, it is also knowing that God forgives you and loves you, and that's what brings joy. And that's what happens here even in chapter 9. Because once it talks about how they confessed, and they confessed for their sin, and they poured it out, and they mourned where they have fallen away from God, they then begin to pray, but God, you are merciful and compassionate and graceful and kind. Over and over again, you read in chapter 9 those phrases, or even at the beginning of your bulletin there underneath the picture. This is a very important phrase that will be said throughout their prayers and after they hear the stories of their ancestors. A reminder in their act of confession that they are, in fact, forgiven because God is merciful, compassionate, and kind. And that is the good news. It's like hearing the word of God and crying with joy because it's so beautiful. It's pouring out your heart and soul to God and one another to be accountable, and then be receiving that God loves you, that God is calling to you, and that God wants you to know God more and to be restored and renewed. And one of the traditions of the Catholic Church that I absolutely love is an act of confession. That they make the church members be accountable, or they did at one point, I don't know anymore, but at one point, you had to go to confession in order to receive communion. That you had to be in this moment of admitting where you failed in the week. Although they do it with like a priest, which is good too, because you're being accountable again, one-on-one to somebody who keeps you accountable. The good news is that they have this practice of not to feel bad about yourself, but to acknowledge that God is great, and I sometimes fail to even see that because I turn and gone my own way. I've kind of decided one of my statements as a pastor, I guess you can call this my belief statement, is if somebody asks me, what is your goal or how do you foresee ministry going? And my response is that I don't have a clue, but I trust that God does. I don't know what I'm doing, but God knows what he's doing. And I know that sounds strange to believe, but what it is me stepping out of the way and saying, I don't know, God, but you do. I know you, God, and I love you, and I don't know where this is going to go. I don't even know if I have a clue each day what I'm doing, but I trust that God does, and that God will guide me. And that's a faith where we trust that God is merciful and compassionate and forgiving and loving and will guide us. So to connect this into our study, which is about Nehemiah, yes, but it's about rebuilding the church. Today, it's about rebuilding the church through our worship. That worship is not about the things that we disagree the most on. That when they worshiped and they came together, they heard the word of the Lord read. They heard good news and encouragement that they were forgiven after they had a moment of repentance. And they worshiped God. In the part that I did not read, but verses 4 through 6, I believe it is, there's a moment where they worship God, and it says that they stood up to worship the Lord. That they no longer could just sit. They stood up and worshiped the Lord. In other places in Scripture, they lay flat on their face on the ground in submission to worship God who is so great and wonderful, even when we're not that great and wonderful. Or God who still forgives and loves us when we are stiff-necked and do our own thing. That worship then, the church, is gathering together and acknowledging when we have messed up, when we have failed personally, but also as a church, when all of us have not done what God has called us to, or we have turned away, or we have shown hatred instead of love. And it gathers us together to confess those and to receive hope and good news. To receive the message that you are loved, that I am loved, that everyone here in this place and beyond these walls are loved by God, and that God has not left us, even if we, in fact, have left God. That the church, then, is people gathering together, professing the same thing on their hearts. God, I'm not perfect. I don't have anything figured out, but you are perfect, and you are good, and you are gracious, and you are kind. And that's what they are doing here in this chapter 9. That they've gathered to worship, they've heard the stories, they've been reminded of their ancestors' struggles with sin, and they themselves are not perfect. They're going to admit their sins and then receive and remember the good news. But God, you are faithful, you are kind, you are gracious, and you are merciful. And then that is how the church then their next step, being reminded of the core of what worship is. It's not style, it's not structure, it's not thoughts and similar theologies. It's gathering together to worship the same God of love and grace and forgiveness and mercy that our Israelite brother and sisters knew from the beginning of time. This connection of a God who has been with us and will continue to be with us even when we turn away. Next week, we will continue with our last time in Nehemiah in chapter 10. And in chapter 10, although it's not the last book of the Bible, it is a continuation of worship. In it is more details of now that they've worshiped and they've acknowledged who God is and they've been brought back home to God's love and embrace, they will then look at more of the traditional church ideas such as tithing, bringing your first fruits to the Levites, who are the priests, to the temple to help supply the needs of not just the Levites but the community. That too is part of what worship is. So continuation the next week is now that they have done the hard work. This is probably the hardest work of the entire book. The wall was a lot of work, I'm sure, and all the tiring nights and days and worry of attack. But the hard work is their soul, of being reconnected to God, being reminded that they are loved and that they're not perfect, that they have failed, but God is perfect and has never failed. And once they have done the hard work, restoring their personal lives, restoring the community into God's love and hope, then they begin with more of the details. How do we function together as a worship? How do we make sure that all of the needs are met with food and housing and practical needs that people have to have too? But for now, we are left with this wonderful story here in chapter 9, this wonderful action of worship, continuation of faith. They hear the word of the Lord. They cry with joy because it's been so long. They've gathered home that emotionally they also realize, I'm unworthy of this great, joyous God. And they confess their sins, and God forgives them with God's great mercy and love. And they begin praising the Lord and remembering whose they belong to, a God of endless mercy. Let us pray. God, we know we are not perfect. We know we fail, and we, like the Israelites, become stiff-necked. We're caught on our own schedule, our own way of life. We've turned away sometimes in our own direction, or we've hardened our hearts to your love. God, we pray that you might surround us with your mercy and grace and compassion, so that we might be led back into a wonderful and joyous celebration of worship, a worship of you, God, that we might be set right on the path, a path that leads us closer to you and not away. But God, we thank you. We thank you already knowing that when we do turn away, you will be there to pick us up and to guide us and set us back in the path over and over again, endlessly, because your mercy and grace are endless. God, do the work in us. Do the hard work, the challenging work that changes who we are so that tomorrow we are not the same that we are today, so that even an hour from now we have been changed by your work. Do the work in us, God, and help us then to do your work to those around us each day by sharing your love. And God, we want to give you thanks. We want to give you joy that your grace and faithfulness and strength has guided us here in this place for good news of tests, God, and for your continual presence and love. God, we ask this as we join together, remembering and knowing the prayer that your Son, Jesus, taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I love the fact that, you know, the Bible tells us to remember, you know, as they, in the Nehemiah, you know, they remembered being freed from Egypt. It builds our faith. It really gives us, it gives us hope. My friend Fernando, his testimony of how God intercedes and you know, healing, it's just great. We do need it. So, with that, let us remember this.
Guitar.
they too will want to know, what is it that makes you different? And you can share with them, it is the Lord who is forgiving and compassionate. Let that be your hope and joy this day as you leave this place and go back into the world around you, now and forever.
You do.